Hello everyone, is the Prophet Michael David, aka Aries, and today we are going to go over my claim as the Christian end times prophet. Once again, I am not Jesus, nor am I the reincarnation of Jesus. As I have stated many times before, I am the reincarnation of Yosef, eldest son of Raquel, he who is most commonly known as Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. Older man, or from much longer ago than Jesus. He's the guy in Genesis, at the end of Genesis. But today is about my claim in Christianity, and it's because it is Christianity, it's going to cover not just Jesus, but his extended family as well, because that entire family was chock full of prophets. Jesus wasn't the only one. Okay, we're going to do this in a bit roundabout way because I've made some promises about some other stuff that I would explain more clearly before, and I will. But so the worst thing about Christianity is basically the priests and the books in general. And we're going to get to this at the end, but the books are not immutable. It's pretty obvious they've changed them or cherry-picked them. But one of the worst ways that they have cherry-picked them, and what's one of the most striking things about Christianity when you actually read the stories or know about the stories, is that Jesus is only described when he's younger, his birth, and then a couple stories when he's around 12 years old, one where he's stretching boards for his father Joseph, and one where he accidentally got left in Jerusalem during Passover, and they found him in the temple. But the only other stories about Jesus are when he begins his ministry, when he is around 30 years old. So that leaves out all the years Jesus was from 13 till 29, which means it leaves out all of Jesus's teenage years and 20s, which are like the most formative years for almost all men. Women too, but a whole lot of things change between 12 and 30. You know, young, angsty teens, puberty, girls, your relationship with your mother and your father changes. And then early 20s are just as angsty, but people are more rebellious. And then you get to your mid-20s and then your late 20s. But those are the most formative years for any man or woman. So the sheer fact that there are stories, that there aren't stories in the Bible, any of them, about when Jesus lived during those years is a huge red flag. If there are no stories about Jesus from the year 13 to 29, then obviously he did not exist, but Jesus did exist. So what happened to those stories? Well, again, we'll get to this at the end, why Christianity did this, but there are probably many stories about Jesus from 13 to 29, but they're buried somewhere underneath the Vatican because they never wanted people to read them. And why would they do that in very short, broad strokes? Because those stories make Jesus seem less divine and his mother Mary and maybe some other people more divine. That's why they took them out. All right, so that's a screenshot of the wiki page that talks about Jesus' crucifixion. Or at least the most likely dates. And as you can see, the most likely one is April 3rd in the year AD 33. So Jesus was 33 and died on the 3rd. You can also see that it matches up pretty well with my Aries birthday. And you might say, well, that's because it's close to Easter, but Easter can vary by a month. My Aries birthday cannot. It's always April 5th. But the important part about that screenshot is we got to talk about crucifixion itself. And this is, I promise to tell you guys how I knew that Jesus was in judgment for, after he died, for exactly 2 days, 30 minutes, and 14.4 seconds. Okay, so how do I get that exact time frame? And this is a very sad part of the story. A lot of it is. All right, as the saying goes, a day in heaven is equal to 1,000 years on earth. And so if you do that conversion and you convert 2 days, 30 minutes, and 14.4 seconds from a day is to 1,000 years, you'll come out with exactly 2,021 years. In other words, God was so pissed about Jesus that God maxed out the maximum allotted time in between prophets. So from our perspective, Jesus died this year, 2023 years ago. But from Jesus' perspective, he got out in 2 days, 30 minutes, and 14.4 seconds. All right, and now even more about crucifixion, whether you want to hear it or not. There's a lot of stories about when Jesus was crucified, some of the other parts of it, that when he was up on the cross, that, you know, they had the thorn, crown of thorns on his head, and the had this got speared in the side. All right, the thorns was just to mock him, obviously, for proclaiming himself Mashiach, which eventually becomes the king of the Jews. But the I don't think the spear thing, I know it wasn't to hurt him, even though it did. They were trying to puncture his lung so that he would suffocate faster. And that's the part you need to understand about crucifixion is it's never blood loss or anything that kills people when they're being crucified or starving to death or from the elements. They always suffocate to death because as you're hanging on the cross, eventually people will fight for life instinctively, but eventually your shoulders and your arms fatigue, and so it starts to crush your chest. And then the only thing you can do to keep your chest from being crushed and you suffocate is you put the pressure on your legs until they fatigue, and then that's when you finally suffocate. So that's what happens to people when they're crucified. And the Romans were crucified a lot of people, not just Jesus. And they were more apt just to leave them up on the cross as long as it took them to die. But Jesus was convicted and crucified and died on Friday. And there was a reason why he was always going to die on Friday. They weren't going to let him go much longer. The reason why this is this. The Romans didn't really care about much religion. I mean, they just took the Greek gods and copied those. They were all about conquest, and that's pretty much it. But not all of them were totally evil. I mean, yeah, the Roman soldiers that crucified Jesus had to do that, or they'd probably be killed themselves. But they weren't going to let Jesus be alive on that cross when the sun went down on Friday. And remember, to the ancients, the day ended when the sun went down, because they have no clocks. They didn't know when midnight was. So they always calculated the end of the day ending at sundown and the next day beginning. So if Jesus would have had survived until sunset, he would have died on Saturday. And the Romans weren't going to let that happen, because even though they didn't care about religion, they did realize this like obscure prophecy about how the Mashiach would die on the Sabbath, the Saturday of Passover. And if Jesus had lived about half an hour longer, then he would have died on a Saturday, but he didn't. So what the Romans would do when they wanted a Jewish person to die real quickly on the cross, like real quickly, they weren't willing to let their muscles fatigue and suffocate, is that they would go around with sledgehammers and they would break the legs of the people. And in that way, as soon as their upper body fatigued, their broken legs and shock just wouldn't hold up their body and they would suffocate real quickly. But the apostles didn't want that to happen to Jesus. And so it was easier. And the Romans were probably right there with the sledgehammer, 30 minutes before sunset. Sunset only takes about 5 minutes. So they could see it getting low on the horizon. And the Roman soldiers probably told the apostles, like, listen, he's going to die before sunset one way or the other. So that's why they probably took that real sharp spear, speared him as mercifully as they could between his ribs to puncture his lung, so that he would suffocate faster, so that he wouldn't get his legs broken by the Romans. In some universes, I'm sure, he's probably stabbed on both sides because he still wasn't dying quick enough and they didn't want his legs get broken. But in this universe, it's only on one side. Well, video is already 9 minutes long. I haven't even got to Mary yet. But now we have to get to Mary, then we're going to go full circle and then go all the way back. And that is a screenshot I got from somewhere on the internet. I'm going to go more in depth with Mary in my next video on Islam, End Times Prophet, because Mary is huge in Islam. So is Jesus. He's just called Isa. But in that one, I will fully explain why I always call Mary the Prophet Mary when you guys call her the Virgin Mary, and why I think all Muslims should call her the Prophet Mary. All right, there's another screenshot from Mary's wiki page. I only put that in there to show that how much Jesus bias that everybody has all the time. Because in there, it basically says there's no way that Mary could have been in the table because it was against whatever the laws, but I assure you that Mary was inside the table. Again, there's some abstract prophecy about the Mashiach has to have been in the Holy of Holies, which is almost impossible because that really is attended by the sons of Aaron. All right, now we're going to talk about more of Jesus' extended family. You could probably tell from the first screenshot about Mary and everything, but in the Quran, Mary's mother is known as Hannah, and her father is known as Imran, who in Christianity are Saint Anne and Joachim. But supposedly, Saint Anne had a sister who may or may not have been Elizabeth. They were related somehow, but somehow Elizabeth was either the cousin or older cousin, much older cousin, or aunt of Mary, and her husband was named Zachariah, and those two were the mother and father of John, he who is most commonly known as John the Baptist. All right, those four screenshots are the description from Wiki of the birth of John the Baptist. And as you can see, Elizabeth and Zechariah were also both prophets, and the angel Gabriel went to Elizabeth and told her that she would have a miracle baby named John, very much like Mary's story. And that prophet and that son would be one of God's greatest prophets. Quick couple notes. I would like to point out that at the very top that it says that Elizabeth was a descendant, one of the daughters of Aaron, which means she was actually a descendant of the Levites. But the most important thing I want to point out is this. According to the story, Gabriel told Mary that Elizabeth was pregnant as well. And so by the time Mary got to Elizabeth, Elizabeth was already 3 months pregnant. And Mary was just pregnant by God or Gabriel or whoever the current interpretation is. And Mary stayed with Elizabeth for 3 months and then she left. So according to the story, and then shortly thereafter, like a week, because 6 months and then Mary was there for another 3 months is 9 months. And then Mary left. And then shortly thereafter, Elizabeth had John. And then the whole story about how they didn't think that they would really name him John, that his name was going to be Zechariah because there was no Johns in the family. But then Zechariah wrote on the chalkboard, his name is John, and then he got his speech back. Now, what rings completely untrue about this story is, and you can look into it, about how one exclaimed to the other, I am so happy to be in presence of the mother of my Lord. And it's always assumed that Mary says that, or I'm sorry, Elizabeth says that to Mary, even though Mary isn't showing. But if you try to explain that to an AI or an alien, they would be like, no, obviously it's Mary saying that to Elizabeth. The second part is that Mary would have never left right before Elizabeth gave birth, because women try to be supportive of each other, especially during childbirth, because while baby making was almost a zero mortality rate for men, the mortality rate for moms, mothers, and babies has never been zero. Many, many babies and many, many mothers have died during childbirth. And so there'd be no way that Mary would abandon Elizabeth when she was 9 months pregnant and just about to give birth. She definitely would have stayed. Also, names. Jesus' name really isn't Jesus, or wasn't Jesus back in the day, and John wasn't named John. It was either Hebrew, or I think it was more, they spoke Aramaic, but Jesus' given name was Yeshua, and John's given name was Johannes. The reason why, we've talked about this before, so how did Yeshua become Jesus? Well, when they started translating the early works of the apostles and everything, everything was translated and retranslated into Greek. And Greek didn't have the Y sound, really, or all the Y sounds turned into J or G sounds. So Yeshua became Jesus. So Yeshua the Messiah, or Yeshua the Mashiach, became Jesus Christos. And then when it was anglicized even more, became Jesus Christ. We've spoken about this before. And then Johannes is the same way. Johannes became Jonathan or John. So, and most people don't know that Jesus and John were born during the same year, because after John was born, even in the Bible, haven't read the whole part of the Bible up to that point, that I did read that is the birth of Jesus comes right after that. And by the time Mary left, she would have been only 3 months pregnant. But shortly thereafter, she had Jesus in Bethlehem, which brings me to my last point. Like I said before, when my mother died, I inherited her Bible and everything. And she had the bookmark in there, and I was wondering one day where the bookmark was. And because of the lighting, I'm not even going to try to read it now. But the portion of the Bible that it was at the part where she had Jesus, birthed Jesus in Bethlehem. But Bethlehem wasn't the original name for that town. The original name for Bethlehem was the town of David, because I'm assuming that's where David, King David, when he had to flee from Saul and Saul's son in Jerusalem, that's where he hid out. So Jesus being born in Bethlehem, in a way you could say that Jesus was a son of David, just like some people today, if they're, you know, born and raised in Philly, they might say that they're sons and daughters of Philly. People from all time have attributed the places where they were born that way. So now you really smart, quick people can see that I'm really dancing around. But like I said, I'm trying to Scooby-Doo mystery this for you guys to figure it out yourself. But most people don't know that Jesus and John were born only a few months apart. And most people don't know they were actually related family, and that family had a lot of prophets in it. And most people don't know that if you would take the best translations of their names into English today, it wouldn't be Jesus and John, it would be Josh and John. So, why did Christianity then fall off the tracks, so to speak, and who is ultimately responsible for it? Because like I said, they did change these books, or they've cherry-picked them as much as they can. You got to remember, the people that wrote those books weren't bona fide prophets. They didn't say that they talked to the angel of the Lord or any manifestation of the angel of the Lord or the Creator God. So what happened was they decided that Jesus as a prophet wasn't influential enough, so they had to turn Jesus into God himself, make him more divine. And the first person that started with, who gave a certain sect of Christians the space to do this eventually, was this guy. That is he who is most commonly known as Paul the Apostle, except that he wasn't one of Jesus' apostles. He was a guy that came like a generation later and actually persecuted a lot of Jesus' early followers, right up to the point where he allegedly had a religious experience and met Jesus and decided that he was basically Christianity's great prophets, that he was a true apostle, but he just wasn't one of Jesus's apostles because he wasn't born at the right time, which is stupid. He's just a guy with delusions of grandeur. Unfortunately, he came up with a lot of the ideas about Jesus that were later adopted by Christianity, which differed a lot with Judaism at the time, and they are the beliefs that are most commonly held today by many Christian, if not most Christian, sects. You could say that most of Christianity is based off of Paul's teachings and interpretations than Jesus himself. And here comes to the crux of the argument, and I'm trying to wrap this up. That is called the Council of Nicaea, or the first one. Many of you have heard of it. It happened in 325 AD, so over 300 years after Jesus had died. And what this council did was, number one, they introduced the Holy Trinity, which made Jesus both God, the Son of God, and the Holy Spirit, in a way that no Christian, in my opinion, has ever been able to properly explain. They dance around it constantly. The other thing they did, as has been noted before, is they just whitewashed the ever-living bejesus out of Jesus. So much so that Da Vinci made fun of them by putting like mascara on Jesus in a lot of his pictures. But nothing good came out of that council. And that's ultimately what they did, and why they did that with the Trinity was that Jesus, as a mortal prophet, could only do so much for them. But an immortal prophet dying for sins, his sins or the sins of his apostles or the people at the time, could easily be explained, but you can't sell that to people. If Jesus was actually God, the only avatar of the creator God ever, and it was actually God in mortal form that died on the cross, well, God is infinite and all-powerful. So then God just didn't die for Jesus' sins or the people's sins at the time. Jesus died for everyone's sins all time, which means that they could sell that to people. Listen, first they could do it with priests. You go to confession, you tell the priests a bunch of bad stuff, and they tell you to say a dozen Hail Marys, and you're cleansed of your sin, you know? And in a lot of Christian sects, you don't even have to do that. All you have to say is, like, we're all sinners. Jesus died on the cross for our sins, which means I can say whatever I want. I can do whatever I want. I can act in any way I want to. And even if it's a sin, all I have to say is, Jesus is my Lord and Savior, and he died for my sins. And then I'm as sinless as the day as I was born. Do you think it actually works that way? Do you think actually that's how the God would allow any person just to discard their own sins any time of day that they wanted to, or any other person, or any rock? No. You live, you sin, some people more than others, you carry all of them until the day you died, and you are judged by the angel of the Lord for it. That's how it goes with every mortal. Every mortal. I've said this before, I can't dumb it down more than that. All right, I'm going to sign off. I did leave a couple, you know, lines for you guys to read between, and you know, if you watch this entire video, please watch the next one, which is Islam, and then Judaism after that. Again, I'm going from west to east across the world here, but I think that's enough for today. So as always, rule number one, do not touch each other without another person's consent, aka do not hurt each other. And rule number two, it's all about honesty. Lies are a tech down, aka try not to lie. All right, y'all have a good day. I will talk to you later.